Okay, so we'll talk about reading financial statements. There are financial versus managerial accounting. And at the heart of this is a company's balance sheet and income statement. So a balance sheet is going to be a list of all the assets a company has, minus all the liabilities the company has. How much stuff does it have, minus how much stuff does it owe, and then whatever's left over, that's the value of the company. An income statement would be for a period of time, usually they're done monthly or quarterly, how much money came in during that period and how much money went out during that period. So it's more of a localized, how good is the company doing lately versus overall how well it's doing. So one of the differences, like I said, one of the differences between financial and managerial accounting is, financial accounting is not meant for making managerial decisions, it's just to be an overall evaluation of how the company is doing. Management or cost accounting might be more pinpointing on a decision you have to make management. So for example, I don't know if you guys know, so Amazon.com currently loses money, right? But it's a very, you know, they wouldn't say, oh, we lost a lot of money this month, let's close the company down. The reason is because the projection is they'll be making profits in the future. So from a management point of view, you wouldn't want to close the company down because it lost money last month. The company still fell from a management point of view. From a financial accounting point of view, it's losing. So those, you know, two different types of accounting. Okay, so questions that come up might be, when do you realize money that's coming in? So for example, if you were to sell a product, right now you might think if it's a retail store, somebody puts a sweater on the counter and they give you money and you sold the product and you got the money right away. But sometimes you can sell products where you don't get the money when the product is ordered. The product gets ordered, it gets delivered, there's an invoice sent out telling someone now that you have the product, you owe us money, and then eventually they pay for it. So what would be a good time to record the sale as money coming into your company? Or could you think of a reason why you might do it? One company might do it one way and another company might do it another way. So, just, I don't know, any thoughts? Okay. So for example, like I said, it's a retail store. When you receive the money, when the product gets sold, it's usually the same time. But a company like Lucent Technologies, which sells telecommunications equipment to internet startup companies, they would sell the equipment and the company would say, we'll pay for it over the next 4 years. Because they don't have money yet. Because it's a startup company, they haven't gotten profits yet. So they'll pay for it over the next 4 years. So let's say you sell $10 million worth of equipment to a startup company, and they're gonna pay you $2.5 million for the next 4 years. When would you say on your balance sheet, when would you say the money came in? You say the whole $10 million came in at the beginning? What's that? So would you say like a little each year? Or would you say we got the whole sale the first year? Would you say our company's now worth $10 million more because we have the sale? Well, one reason, some people argue it doesn't really matter, but sometimes you might think, what if you don't get paid in the future? Maybe you should only book it when you get paid. So that's at this one, when the payment's received. Should you book it when the service is delivered? It could also be, and this happens with internet startup companies, you're selling a service, you haven't even made it yet. They say, can your six employees make a website that will do blah, blah, blah? And you say, yes, we can do that, but you need 6 months to build it. So you haven't even built it yet. So is it when it gets ordered, when you finally built it and gave it to them, when you sent them a bill, or when they actually paid for it? And when do you think it, in what cases do you think that one would be more accurate or inaccurate than another? So one thing you might want to think about, if you do it when the payment is received, you might be spending a lot of money delivering the product, and you have no income to cover that cost. So you might want to say, well, we know we're going to get income. Hopefully we're going to get income. And we'd like to say on an income statement, well, this much came in and this much went out, so we're not having a bad month. So it's actually, it's somewhat debatable when to do this. And another interesting question is, can we estimate the value of a company based on the financial statements? And if we do that, how they pick to report it might actually throw off our estimates. So, for example, we talked in a previous class about putting money into an investment. So suppose you had a risk-free interest rate of 5%. Suppose you could put money in a bank or buy safe bonds and they'll pay 5% a year. And suppose you have an account. I'm not going to tell you how much money's in the account, but you own the account. And the account is currently paying $10 million a year from the interest. So you have some amount of money and you keep getting 5% every year, and that comes out to $10 million a year. So the question is, what is your account worth? So can you figure out what the account is worth based on the interest it's putting out? So it would be, whatever your account value is we're trying to figure out, 5% of that is the interest that comes out. And let's say you notice it's giving out $10 million a year. That means the account value is $200 million. Because 5% of that would be $10 million. So if you didn't know what the account value was, usually when you have a bank account, you know how much money's in the account, but pretend you didn't know it, all you know is the interest coming out of it. Well, you could guess the value of the account. Well, it's somewhat similar. Suppose you had some internet startup company that produces $10 million a year. You know, you have some employees, you're paying rent on a building, you're paying insurance, the cost of the employee's salaries, you have all this cost, and then it has revenue coming in. And if you subtract the cost from the revenue, there's $10 million a year left over. What is this company worth? Well, it's kind of like an account that's generating $10 million. So that would be the same thing. The company would be worth approximately $200 million. But what's a little fishy about that estimate? If we're trying to evaluate a startup company versus evaluating a bank account. So the bank account each year is going to produce pretty close to this number year after year. The interest rates go down a little bit, this will go down a little bit. If the interest rates go up a little bit, interest rates go up a little bit. But a lot of times these startup companies are a lot more volatile. You could be making $10 million this year, and then next year you could be losing money. Or the year after that you could be making $50 million. So it's a lot more volatile than a bank account. But this is just kind of the idea. We'll try to keep this in the back of our head. Now, if we were using this on Amazon.com, it's producing a negative number. So you would think the account, the value of the company is a negative number, and that's not true. The reason why it's not true is there's a projection of a lot more growth in the future. Okay. So then there's an accounting that's a thing called a matching. So the cost must be recognized when we have recognized the revenue. So like the same thing, this example of losing technologies. If you go to sell a product and then you're going to get paid over the next 4 years slowly, and there's going to be a cost, maybe some initial cost before you even made the sale, and then some cost to install the product, you have to say, the cost of installing the products gets subtracted from the money they're paying, and then you can show a profit. So, and there's a lot of opportunity to be accepted about that. And then there's also the problem with depreciation. Depreciation is when you have an asset at your company, and as time goes on, it's getting older and older, and you're going to have to repair it or replace it with something new. So you have to take into account that too. Okay, and then there's this principle of prudence. You have to make sure when you're reporting stuff, because especially if it's a publicly traded company, have to make sure the information you're reporting is going to be used by people to evaluate your company. They're going to evaluate the company if they want to buy it, they want to buy stock in it, they want to risk buying bonds issued by your company. So you don't want to overestimate or underestimate value. So just two examples, AOL, American Online. Does anyone use AOL? Nobody uses that anymore? No? Okay. That was one of the original internet startup companies. So they were heavily advertised. So you guys probably don't know this, but they used to mail out these CDs to your house and you plug it into your computer and now you're an AOL member. Did you ever get those? The CDs? No? Okay. So you used to get them in the mail like every week. So anyway, they spent a lot of money advertising. This was when the internet first came out and they wanted to get a lot of users to subscribe to them. So they had a very large advertising budget. So their idea was to advertise a lot the first year, and then when people join for the next 10 years, you don't have to advertise because they're already on your system. So they said, well, why should we take a big loss in the first year? Let's say they spent $10 million advertising. But that was for a 10-year period. Now, years 2 through 10, they're not going to advertise because they've already done all their advertising in the first year. So rather than say we lost all this money the first year, because we lost it spending advertising, they only recorded 1/10 of it the first year, and then put the $9 million left in on their balance sheet as a loss. So it didn't look like they had a bad first year, which they really didn't, if that model was true. They're advertising the first year to get 10 years worth of advertising value. That would be accurate. But if it turns out to not be accurate, suppose by the third year, the fourth year, there are other companies competing, and now they have to do more advertising than they got their advertising reported. And they also had a problem when they laid off employees. They paid off some, you know, 6 months' salary to everybody when they left. And then they reported that money, they reported the cost of restructuring their balance sheet. So again, like I say, where you record this stuff is going to play a role in how your company is perceived. And if you want your company to be falsely perceived as doing well, you report it in different sections of your account, which is what the rules against doing. So basically, the way cash flows with a company is you have cash, okay, and then there's changes in the value of your company. So that could go up or down, cash flow up or down. Changes in liabilities, how much money is owed to your company and how much you owe out. Taxes get paid out of your cash. Interest gets paid out of your cash. And then if you issue stock, then you pay dividends to the stockholders. That comes out of your cash. So cash is, you know, money that you have on hand. Accounts receivable is all the money that companies owe your company but haven't paid yet. So your accounts receivable is money that's owed to you. When the money finally comes in, you collect the receivables, that becomes cash. That's what this red line is. Your inventory is all the products that you have sale. So anything that's in your inventory, if you ship it out to somebody and you bill them, then that becomes an accounts receivable. So you have a product, you send it out to somebody. You've now lost value because you don't have this product in your warehouse anymore, but somebody owes you money for it. So it moves from the inventory to accounts receivable. When they eventually pay, it moves to cash. And there's also a way of skipping over, selling something out of your inventory and having it pay right away. Okay. Then you can take some of your cash and you can decide that you want to, let's say you want to open up a new building. Your company has, you know, a building and you have too many employees or whatever, you want to buy a new building. So you can take some of your cash and you can invest it into some asset, like a new building. Then over time, the asset starts decreasing in value, the building gets old and worn out and stuff losing value. And as it depreciates, you kind of put that into your inventory. Okay, so basically this is the money that keeps moving through your company. So one thing you want to do, we'd like to have what they call a balance sheet. We'd like to capture this whole thing and say how much stuff do we have, how much money do we owe out, and what is the net value of the overall company. But we'd also like to know on a small term basis, maybe a monthly basis, how much money came in during a particular month and how much money went out during a particular month. So maybe if we're having a bad month, we should look what's happening. So, you know, what, we have too many expenses, too many employees. But we didn't have enough sales that month, so we want to take a look at that. So when we're interpreting financial statements, financial snapshot at a point in time of all the company's assets against. So what we'll end up doing is we'll take all our assets, everything we have, minus all what we owe out, whatever's left over. Good thing about a minus sign here equals this, so these two together equal assets. Okay, so the amount of assets you have minus the amount of liabilities, how much you owe out, whatever's left over is the shareholders or the owners' equity in the company, how much value you have. Okay, so then yeah, the interesting question is if you're short on cash, can we somehow spend some of this money? Okay. So we'll talk about bonds later on, of course. We could borrow money. But we could borrow money from people and use the company's equity as guaranteed to pay the money back. Okay, so on this balance sheet, we have our asset, which is liquid assets, accounts receivable, money that is owed to us but hasn't been paid yet. Our inventory, the products we have, the amount of the products we have on our shelf. And then net fixed assets like buildings, trucks, anything like that, and then other assets that can come up. And then liabilities and the shareholders' equity is short-term borrowing, so if we've issued bonds or even out loans, borrowed money from people or businesses. Accounts payable, that's money owed to us. The net accrual, so that could be an accounting of money that was owed to us, but some of it has been paid, some of it hasn't been paid. Long-term debt is really what bonds are. And then the owner's equity, how much of the ownership of the company is what's left over. So this column should equal this column. Of course, the owner's equity part will change. It'll basically be whatever our assets are, minus our liabilities, will become what the owner's. So that would get captured in a balance sheet. So here's an example of Microsoft's balance sheet. This was on Yahoo Finance from 2004. So, but this was their balance sheet. So they listed out all the assets that they have. And that came to a net worth of $65 million. Well, this would be their current assets and then their long-term investments. So, for example, the goodwill is like, you know, the value of their name. The name Microsoft has a certain value to it. You say, what's that value? You know, what's the value of that name? And then, so if you added up all their assets together, total assets would be $89 million. And then their liabilities was all the money that they had owed out. So this accumulated all of their money that was owed out. And then the total liabilities were $19 million. So their assets, everything they have in value is $89 million. And their debt is $19 million. When you subtract that, you get about $70 million to the owner's equity. So whatever that owner's equity is, this is how much money would be in, you know, common stock. And so then if you took the number of shares of stock that are out there and divided it by this number, that would be a good estimate of what one share of the stock should be worth. So we went over that example. If you're like part owner of a restaurant and you own 1/10 of the restaurant, and then whatever the value of the restaurant is, if you went to share and sell your 1/10 of the share, it would be whatever the value of the restaurant is divided by 10. So if this is the value of the company, divide that by the number of shares, that would be a good estimate of what the shares should be selling. Okay, so then the income statement of a company. So like I say, the balance sheet is probably the, you know, two most important financial statements are the balance sheet, which is all the company's assets minus all the money the company owes out and whatever's left over for working the company. The other one is usually done on a monthly basis. It's how much money came in and how much money went out on a particular month. So things you want to keep a look at is net sales. So how much money did you sell minus how much money it cost to make the product. Gross profit. So that's the profit before taxes. What's your operating profit? What are your earnings before taxes and interest? What are your earnings before taxes without the interest point? And then earnings after taxes. So debt. So a standard income statement would have these categories on it. You have your net sales, so the cost of goods that were sold, how much did it cost you to make the goods that you sold. Gross profit, administrative and selling expenses, and the depreciation on the products you have, or the assets that you have. Your operating profit, so the profit from your main business, plus or minus any gains or losses, and then plus any other income from financial investments, like interest on some of your assets. And then we'd also want to show what's going out. So the earnings before interest and taxes, and earnings before taxes, and earnings after taxes. And also taxes, you know, don't do it as going out, would also be what's left after all the earnings before. So here's Microsoft's fiscal tax.
Here's Microsoft's
balance sheet.
Tilt this down a little. Okay.
So this was Microsoft's balance sheet also for that same time period. I'm sorry, their income statement. Their income statement. So this section would be all the revenue that came in, gross profit that came in. And then the operating income or loss is this section. And then this would be, you know, how much money they made before taxes and interest. And eventually the net income is $1,300,000. So at a time when the company was worth, the net worth of the company was $70 million. It had a quarter. This is the first quarter of the year. So this is the 3 month period. During the 3 month period, they made a profit of $1.3 million. So you might think, well, if it's only making $1.3 million, why is it worth $70 million? Well, so first of all, if we wanted to try to now guess the value of the company, could we guess it's just from this quarter? Like, what would, so in other words, if you say, oh, this company is working, it's like a bank account. It keeps making a profit. It made a profit of $1.3 million for a quarter. Times four would be what? A little over $5 million a year. If a bank account paid, let's say interest rates at this time was 5% a year, that would be like the company's worth $100 million. And it keeps giving $5 million a year in interest, right? If you had $100 million in the bank, and you could get 5% interest, it would generate $5 million a year, right? So that would mean, if you calculate it backwards, the company's worth $100 million. So if the company's worth $100 million, and you're guessing that because you're getting $5 million a year, a little over $5 million a year, you're making the assumption you're going to keep doing this year after year after year for the near future, which isn't necessarily true. But if we were to take this number and try to guess the value of the company, it would be a little over $100 million. But then if you look at the balance sheet for the same period, you'd realize its net worth is about $70 million. So you kind of have two different ways of looking at the income. And So this might be a better estimate of it, but a balance sheet doesn't tell you anything about whether the future is going to be really good or really bad. It just tells you everything added up. So like I say, if you did a balance sheet on Amazon.com, it would, well, it's interesting. They would have software that has a certain amount of value because the more companies that go on Amazon.com to sell products and the more people shop, the more money they make. So they would have assets that were worth a lot of money. So their balance sheet might show a high number, but their income statement would show a negative number. Because they have a lot of employees and they're selling a lot of packages, but it right now costs more money to run the company than it does the profits coming in. So they would actually show a negative number. You try to calculate the company's net worth from the negative number, you get a big negative number. It's not a negative number. So you really have to look at both of these, both the income and the balance income. So, like I said, this is a financial accounting kind of high level overview. What can we say about this? You can't quite tell everything about a company simply from its balance sheet. The balance sheet just tells you all the assets the company has minus all the liabilities at the present moment. But it doesn't say anything about the near future. It's just a picture of the overall company. The income statement tells you what happened in the last quarter. So maybe this number could be high because they didn't have to do any advertising because they did a lot of advertising the previous year. And it's not showing up. So maybe the next year they have to do a big round of advertising and they don't have bad quarters. So you have to kind of look at both. Okay.